Hey there guys, welcome back to my blind playthrough of the Tormented Souls demo. And we're at least making some progress in this very shitty game. And I know I said this was definitely like a 1 out of 10 for me, but I told Ether when I was premiering my first part of this blind playthrough that this game is a 0.1 out of 10. I think a 1 out of 10 is way too generous of a rating for this game. This is honestly one of the worst games I've ever played. And I don't see the rest of the game getting good at all. And Ether did disclose a bit of details about the full game. And apparently there are some things about the demo that are different to the full game. Like, for instance, you know that puzzle I just did where it involved the Pentagon and the soldier? Well, apparently that whole piece of paper that shows the Pentagon and the soldier, it doesn't exist in the main game. So how anyone's meant to figure that out, or at least understand the context of it without any kind of clear solution when the solution itself is already very vague in its interpretation, that right there is a very bad puzzle design. But my low expectations regarding this game have not changed in the slightest. And I honestly feel like this game right now, it's going through an identity crisis, because when I was discussing those two enemies in the waiting room area with Ether, he mentioned that you are supposed to kill them, but that's just odd because this is the very first part of the game. If this is meant to be a return to classic survival horror, and classic survival horror is just heavily reliant upon the whole idea of enemies serving more as obstacles and actual threats, and it's just easier to run past them because dealing with them is just, it's obnoxious, and you've already seen how dealing with the enemies is very obnoxious in this game. And also, I made a mistake, I should have gone to the waiting room first. But like, if this game is supposed to be a return to classic survival horror, why would they force you to kill those two enemies in the waiting room? And it feels like they're really trying to force you to kill a lot of these enemies, and just, you have to keep your distance because the flinch animations for the enemies allow them to move forward, and if they get close to you and initiate an attack, they just get hyper armor. So why bother putting in stun animations when they can just do that attack the whole time and just get hyper armor? Like, why have them do any kind of movement animation at all? Why have them be in some kind of neutral state? Why not just put in an attack animation that just allows them to move and that's the only thing they can do? We'll see how balanced the game is when the enemies can spam that kind of long-range attack and just not flinch in the slightest. And so we've already seen that with the range attack that these legless enemies have, where it's almost impossible, not almost impossible, it is impossible to avoid. I know Ether has mentioned that you can just time your movement at the correct point in their animation in order to bypass it, but I think he just got lucky. I don't really see it as being something that's guaranteed. Like, this game, it's just going through such an identity crisis right now. It can't decide whether it wants you to run past all the enemies and just ignore all the weaponry, or it wants you to just kill all the enemies and just go to all these side areas that honestly feel like main areas at this point, and just really affect the pacing. Like, if they want you to kill the enemies in the waiting room, then why do they not put in some kind of cutscene or put in, like, large amounts of ammunition before dealing with those enemies? Like, if that's meant to be an encounter where you're supposed to kill them, why did they not do that? That's normally how that's communicated in these kind of classic survival horror games. They stack up on a lot of ammunition before these kind of encounters to actually send the right message that you're supposed to kill them. That's normally how that works, but this game doesn't do that, and that's why it just feels like an identity crisis right now. And then we have to get the nail gun right here. And I still need to stack up on a lot of ammunition because I know the amount of ammunition I have right now is not enough, because from what I've noticed, these enemies take about 8 shots to kill. 6 shots to actually stun them, and then 2 more shots to actually finish them off. But that's probably going to be inconsistent, because if this game is anything like a Resident Evil 1 remake, then the enemies have an interval HP system, not a set HP system, meaning that there's a minimum and a maximum HP value, and like within that range, starting from the minimum to the maximum HP value, their health can be different. Because that's how that worked in Resident Evil 1 remake. But I still don't know when this demo ends. I think the demo ends when you use the T-bar handle, because that just seems like a logical point to actually end the demo. And what is the whole point of stopping the generator? It seems like that's going to have some importance later on. Or is that another example of miscommunication on the game's part? So we now need to go to the waiting room and actually get that heart. Oh, no, I'm sorry, that's in the maternity ward where I get the heart. But still, though, probably best I clear out the enemies first, then actually go to the maternity ward. And we'll see how shitty the combat looks. And I've already demonstrated just how bad the animations are in this game, and with how much the enemies love to cheat. So are these? I think this is hit scan based because I somehow hit that guy without seeing him. He's moving forward. It's like, how is that fair? What is the whole point of a flinch animation if it allows them to get an advantage? Do these developers not understand how a fucking flinch animation works in a game? Gosh, she moves so slowly. You call that a sprint animation? It's so, and it looks so effeminate. What is this? That'll continually bother me throughout this whole entire playthrough of the demo. I know Ether mentioned that this was a small development team, but small development teams can do a lot better than this. Like, wasn't Outlast an indie title? I mean, that game is a horror simulator, and the enemies are practically obstacles. But at least the game does embrace dodging and the like, and the movement feels great in Outlast. But how many developers were actually directing Outlast? It felt like a small team. But it still played a lot better than this piece of shit. But it really doesn't matter if it's a small development team or a large development team. Anyone with a brain would actually understand that these issues present with this game are issues that shouldn't be the case if you're an actual human being designing the game. Anyone with a small amount of common sense could at least rationalize that these kind of design choices that this game favors are bad designs. And it's just done this way because settling for less is just the custom of classic survival horror and with these kind of old school games. Because games were practically nothing back then, and very rarely would you ever get a good title. I have so many PS2 titles, and hardly any of them feel great. Like, hardly any of them actually feel functional. I can't imagine why anyone would want to go back to that era of gaming. Oh shit. Oh, fuck you! He's. Fucking bullshit. Like, look at that. Can you just do nothing but that range attack? Why bother putting in all these melee animations? Oh shit. Fuck you. What are they expecting you to do about that range attack? Aside from what Ether's described, but even then, I tried to do what Ether said, and it just wouldn't work. And also, I've asked Ether how many weapons there are in the game, and he described a little bit. He said you can get a shotgun later on in the game, and there's also an additional melee weapon that you can get. Missing a socket, so that's back where that dial door was. And at least I remember the order. Because that's always going to be the case when you're recording like your own commentary. Like you remember like how you phrase certain words and the like, that it just sticks in your head. And if you repeatedly watch back the videos, it only makes it a lot easier for that information to remain in your head. But this triangle here, and then it was the hexagon. But Ether went through the same kind of dilemma with that puzzle. Like, he thought the alien was the circle as well. Like, he told me this. Because, of course, aliens make crop circles, right? So that's one possible logic there. Although he was a little iffy on my logic with saying aliens come from the stars. He didn't really rationalize it to be like that. But I mean, it's a gray matter alien. Like, the very first alien concept is the gray matter alien, which is what's being portrayed right there. And of course, the gray matter aliens, they came in spaceships, so they came from the stars. That was my reasoning. But I guess I can understand why Ether would be a little confused by the solution to that. Okay, so now I gotta head back to the waiting room. And let's see. But Ether has mentioned that there are a lot of puzzles in this game, like an overbearing amount of puzzles. And he does like them, and he says that the first couple of puzzles do not set the proper tone. But still hasn't changed my view on puzzles in survival horror games, or at least in these classic survival horror games. Because it's just so like arcadey and gamey, and they just interrupt the pacing of the game, and it feels like Occam's Razor, like doing a puzzle in a classic survival horror game could easily be substituted with a realistic, oh, just walk down a long corridor, just walk down a long flight of stairs, this and that, and we all know how endurable that is after multiple playthroughs of a game. I mean, it's cool going through it your first time, but your first playthrough has no meaning. And oh, that's where the demo ends. Okay. So I guess I'll conclude this part of the blind playthrough right here. And that has been my full blind playthrough of the Tormented Souls demo. I am still undecided as to whether I should get the full game or not, but hey, it may be enjoyable when I actually shit on this game. Because shitting on games and actually pointing out the objective flaws within them and really pointing out how foolish people are when it comes to their mentalities is part of my charm, right? But yeah, maybe I'll do that. Thank you all for watching, and you take care now.